So many Americans, such as radio personality Fanny Bryce, have often repeated the classic American wisdom, "I've been rich and I've been poor. Believe me, rich is better." Given the apparent truth of that sentiment, how strange and alien Jesus sounds in this Sunday's gospel. Blessed are you who are poor? What could possibly be blessed about being poor? Do poor people in this country or around the world appear blessed to you? Why would Jesus say this? And why would Luke, an elite scribe, write such a terribly untrue thing? Would any poor person on earth believe such nonsense? As we explore this gospel, please keep in mind that the word poor in biblical culture describes a social reality rather than an economic one. Luke chapter 6, verse 17, verses 20 through 26. Jesus came down with the 12 and stood on a stretch of level ground with a great crowd of his disciples and a large number of the people from all Judea and Jerusalem and the coastal region of Tyre and Sidon. And raising his eyes toward his disciples, he said, "Blessed are you who are poor, for the kingdom of God is yours. Blessed are you who are now hungry, for you will be satisfied. Blessed are you who are now weeping, for you will laugh. Blessed are you when people hate you, and when they exclude and insult you, and denounce your name as evil on account of the Son of Man. Rejoice and leap for joy on that day. Look, your reward will be great in Sky Vault, for the fathers treated the prophets in the same way. But woe to you who are rich, for you have received your consolation. Woe to you who are filled now, for you will be hungry. Woe to you who laugh now, for you will grieve and weep. Woe to you when all speak well of you, for their fathers treated the false prophets in this way." My friends, in ancient Syro-Palestine, the peasant population believed that all goods, spiritual as well as material, exist in a finite quantity. So not only were grain and livestock and possessions and land considered finite, but so too was honor, friendship, reputation, love, status, security, power. Everything in life was limited and already distributed. It was distributed at creation, and there is no more to come. If a person loses any of these goods, material as well as spiritual, there simply is no more where that came from. That is how biblical peoples understood goods, the view of the limited good. If this same person suddenly found what he or she had lost, neighbors would be suspicious. They would wonder whether this found item had been stolen, taken from someone else. That was precisely the problem faced by the woman who found her lost coin in Luke chapter 15, verses 8 to 10. The woman didn't have any choice but to summon all her neighbors, spend much more than what she had lost and recovered, assuring them that she had not stolen this piece of jewelry, but rather found what she had lost. How did this commonly shared cultural belief in the limited good shape human behavior? Well, it dictated that every person should be satisfied with whatever is rightfully possessed. Nobody should have a desire to increase possessions. Think about how that would affect our American ideal of upward mobility and keeping up with the Joneses. To have such desire could only be interpreted by biblical people as an expression of greed. Remember the Israelite who asked Jesus to force his brother to divide his family inheritance with him? What did Jesus warn him? "Beware of all greed," Luke chapter 12, verse 15. Jesus believes in the limited good. The Torah, or law, clearly determined that the elder brother is to receive double the younger share, Deuteronomy chapter 21, verse 17. The Galilean peasant day laborer turned folk healer Jesus refused to be a partner in greed. In this cultural context, the labels rich and poor take on a meaning quite different than in our American culture. In the ancient world, a person became rich because he had the power to take wealth from those who were weaker and unable to defend themselves. But in our modern Western world, wealth itself bestows power. It's very different than the ancient Mediterranean world of the Bible, where power was the means of acquiring wealth. In the same way, a poor person in the ancient world of the Bible was powerless, meaning unable to defend inherited status and wealth. Notice in the Bible what kinds of people are associated with the word poor. As a rule, we read in the Bible about the poor, the orphans, and the widows. All these categories of people share in common a certain deficiency in social relationships and consequent powerlessness. The orphan has no adults to protect his interests. The widow, even if she possesses millions of denarii, has no son and therefore has no public voice. She is regularly described, even to this day in many parts of the Middle Eastern world, as a poor widow. Economic considerations enter the picture only incidentally, and then only for the wealthy. So the culturally more appropriate translation of rich and poor in the Bible would be greedy and socially unfortunate. Now let's talk a little bit about the Beatitudes in this light. Often we read the Beatitudes in our English translations this way. Blessed are... But why blessed? What is blessed about being socially unfortunate, poor, hungry, and weeping? A Beatitude proposes a cultural value, cultural belief, or cultural behavior pattern that is truly honorable. In the Mediterranean world of the Bible, in Mediterranean society, the core value is honor, and everybody wants to know what the honorable thing to do is. Well, obviously, being poor, being defrauded of one's wealth, being persecuted, being insulted, slandered, and the like, are not honorable experiences. Anybody suffering these things would be judged as shamed. In the Beatitudes, however, the Lucan Jesus promises a reward from the God of Israel for any Israelite who suffers these shameful experiences. The vast majority of people in the ancient world were poor. This condition was brought about by greedy, wicked people. It was not caused by an economy gone haywire. It was not caused by human laziness. It was not caused by bad luck. The God of Israel was believed to be the ultimate arbiter of true honor, and the honor God bestows is unsurpassable. When God honors the socially unfortunate, everyone will know their true status. So instead of the English translation, "Blessed are you who are poor," it should be something like, "Most honorable are you who are socially unfortunate." And instead of "woe to you who are rich," it should rather be "shameless are you who are greedy." The Luke and Jesus Beatitudes are statements consoling and supporting the socially disadvantaged. They're not attitudes to be acquired by Jesus group members. The social ostracism in verse 22 is always the fate of the poor in agrarian societies. What Luke is suggesting is that social ostracism may become the fate of the greedy rich who join Jesus groups that include the poor or socially disadvantaged. Luke is a rare elite that gets Jesus. He knows the terrible costs involved for rich Jesus group members, but Luke is uncompromising in his demand that these costs be paid. In the Gospel called Luke, Jesus' Beatitudes, therefore, were primarily words of consolation to very poor people who desperately needed to hear good news, this good news. They also pointed to moral qualities that God-fearing Israelites should strive to achieve. For instance, to know one's place and keep it in society, poor. And to protest social injustice, hungry and weeping, which are ritualized elements of protest activities. People who behave in such honor-deserving ways will indeed be honored by the God of Israel, which is the only honor that really counts anyway. Can you argue with that?